today on Inspired Money.
I remember showing up at 4 a.m. and the phone was ringing nonstop. And they were like, hey, do you have this croissant donut? And I said, yeah, we do. And then they're like, I want a dozen. And I'm like, okay. So I write down their order. They're going to come in, you know, an hour or so. And the phone just goes nonstop. And I could tell that our production was not going to keep up with, you know, the actual production of the donuts. You know, we couldn't make them fast enough. The whole wall was covered with orders.
This is episode 151 with owner of DK's Donuts, Mayly Tao. Welcome to Inspired Money. My name is Andy Wong, a managing partner at Runnymede Capital Management. Each week, we bring you an interesting person to help you get inspired, shift your perspectives on money, and achieve incredible things. From making it to giving it away, Inspired Money means making a difference, creating something bigger than oneself, and maybe, just maybe, making the world a better place. Thank you for joining me. Hey, Inspired Moneymaker, welcome back. If this is your first time listening, welcome. So I have a question for you. Do you like donuts? Did you know that the average number of donuts consumed by Americans annually is 10 billion? And the estimated size of the U.S. donut industry, $3.6 billion. Donuts make a lot of people happy. I've definitely seen pure joy on my son's face, along with sprinkles and glaze. We've got Mayly Tao on the show. She's also known as the Donut Princess, and the donut business is in her blood. But as an entrepreneur, she and her brother were not complacent to take over their parents' donut shop. They've made it their own through product innovation and social media marketing. Located in Santa Monica, California, DK's Donuts was named by Food Network as one of the top five donut shops in the United States. Walk in and you'll see 12 different pots of coffee, cream-filled O-Nuts, custom-created Wow Nuts. You're about to learn what those are. And it's open 24 hours a day, 7 days a week, to bring you that sweet joy you crave anytime you need it. In this episode, you'll learn the history of Cambodian immigrants owning donut shops in Southern California, how Mayly created new donut varieties and used social media to build community. And make sure you listen to the end to hear how Mayly is giving back and adapting the business during COVID-19, and how her family is helping those in Cambodia. Now let's get inspired with Mayly Tao. Mayly, welcome to Inspired Money. I'm so excited to have you on the show.
Thank you so much for having me, Andrew.
Let's jump right in. What's your earliest childhood memory of money?
My earliest childhood memory of money is actually with my dad. I remember we were sitting at our old house and, you know, we're sitting on the floor. He brings me a bunch of change and we play this game. It's called Gimme. That's essentially kind of where I learned how to make change. He would get, you know, step by step, little problem solving. He'd be like, okay, I have $5 here. This costs this much. How much change do you need to give back to me? And that's kind of how I first learned how to make change. And that was around the age of 4. And so by the age of 6, my parents, they owned DK's Donuts and Bakery in Santa Monica, California, and they were having me stand right there at the register giving change to people. So my earliest childhood memories of money come from my dad and come from helping my parents out at such a young age at the store. I mean, I couldn't even reach the showcase at that point. I had to stand a little milk crate to give change.
What was it like growing up at DK's Donuts?
Oh, it was very unlike a lot of other people and how they grew up. I would say that I am one of the donut kids of our generation, you know, small pockets of them. Pretty much in the 70s and 80s, we had a large influx of Cambodians come over because of the Khmer Rouge. And when they came here, they were looking for, you know, new opportunities. Some were granted asylum, like my parents. And, you know, they just wanted to figure out some way to make money and live a better life. And so my great uncle Ted, he's actually very famous. He's actually known as the Donut King. So he actually helped a bunch of these Cambodian communities find donut shops and set up their livelihoods here in America. My parents having one of the donut shops. Growing up, I remember my hair always smelled like donuts. I would wake up super early, maybe like 4 or 5 a.m. to go and help my parents at the store. No cartoons on the weekends. You know, it was just helping them out, making sure that everything was running smoothly. And, you know, I spent a lot of my time there. My parents were both immigrants. They came here with nothing. And when they got here, they each worked, you know, anywhere from 12 to 18 hours a day. So there's no real daycare for us. So we pretty much hung out at the shop most of our time.
You are a legitimate donut princess.
Yep. I proclaimed that name for myself after I took over the shop in around 2012, 2013. I had just finished graduating at UCSD. I did a communications degree, had interned for a news station. I worked at UCSD doing PR and marketing, and I came back and had a new vision for the store. And that's kind of where I started to call myself the Donut Princess, to really elevate the donut game in Los Angeles.
I know that you went to college vowing to yourself that you'd never do donuts. So how did you get from there to today?
Working really hard at such a young age and just seeing how hard my parents worked, I never really wanted to come back to the family business. It was always a plan B for me. So when I graduated in 2012 and I actually went in to be a news reporter. So, I mean, I'm in the back of the car of the big van. We're doing reportings of murders and accidents and things that are happening in the military. And we were doing some human interest stories. I was right then and there with the reporters at 2 a.m. at their desk and, you know, seeing these people and seeing how dedicated their lives were to their job. I just felt that there was a higher calling for me. I thought that all the news that we were reporting on, it was all about the ratings. It's not really about the story. Right. And so when I came back to LA, you know, I thought, you know, what is going to really fulfill me? And the first thing I thought of was my family. I could see that they needed help. And I always knew that there was potential with DKs. And I thought, all right, let's give this a shot. And if it's anything that I can leave in this world, it's the legacy of like making my parents proud and putting DK's donuts on the map.
When you went to school, like the idea of you becoming a reporter, that was probably viewed as like the successful, safe career route for you. What was your parents' reaction to you coming back into the family business?
Well, I think on one hand, being a daughter of a very traditional Southeast Asian family, although they wanted me to be a reporter and could see that as like almost a fulfillment to a successful job that's safe, that's not as hard work. At the same time, they missed me. You know, they were always calling me every week saying, hey, when are you going to come home? Hey, when are you going to come home? And I thought, okay, well, I'm going to come home. I think that there was just not that anything at the time that was as interesting to me as leaving this mark for my parents at the shop. So their reaction, they were happy in one sense because I was there and I was such a stable part of the business. I was, you know, stepped in with a new fresh outlook. And at the same time, I think that they knew that I would still be okay regardless.
When you were growing up, how much did you know about your great uncle Ted?
Well, when I was growing up, there was not that much of mentioning of him because he had a terrible gambling problem. So he did not have the best reputation in my family. So I grew up knowing very little about him. It was only until I grew up and started to do a little bit more digging and to really look into the history and the past and to kind of see like, hey, like this is me stepping into the next part of history. This is, you know, I'm making history for my family and for Uncle Ted.
I imagine that he must have come to the United States with very little as well.
Right. So Uncle Ted, he came here before the war was happening. He came here and was very, very poor. He came here with a few other family members. And what happened was, is he started working for a church. So he'd clean the church just so that he, you know, this family who sponsored him and could provide, you know, some kind of assistance to pay back for him to stay there. And one time, one of his host families took him to buy and eat a donut. And he thought, this donut is amazing. How can I have my own store of donuts? And, you know, he pretty much figured it all out by, you know, testing one for himself. And then he would open up another shop and another shop and another shop. So unfortunately, he did lose everything to gambling, but he did make something for history. And there actually is a documentary coming out. It's called The Donut King Film. And it tells a very detailed part of his whole story and how, since donuts are such a big part of the American culture, how the Cambodian donut shops really almost took over all the franchise donut shops of these big chains that had already existed.
It's a fascinating story. You must have been fascinated yourself learning about it. I can't wait to see the movie. When people say that Cambodian donut is delicious, it can trace back to him, right? Like, he's the beginning.
Right. He is the beginning, because at this point, I mean, you have to think about quality and survival. So when you're thinking about these two concepts, so when the Cambodian families came over and, you know, Ted would set them up each with a donut shop, in order to really survive and to make money, you had to be different and more unique than the other donut shops that existed. Number one, you had to make donuts that were crazy fresh and of utmost quality. So while some donut shops that already existed were making donuts out of machines and were making them once a day, Ted and these other Cambodian families knew that, you know, when somebody tries a product and it's delicious, it's the best thing that you've ever had, you will go back to that place no matter what, if it's consistent. When I talk about quality, it's that the Cambodian families who came here, and this is literally their only means to survive, they really produce this special kind of donut. And this special recipe has actually been passed down in our family for generations. But the key ingredient to the success of these Cambodian donut shops is the quality and just the survival part of it all.
And you have many other family members and relatives who are also either in donuts or in the baking industry, right?
My uncle, which is my dad's brother, he actually opened up a baking distribution company where people could order supplies. And then my other auntie, she owns a croissant factory where they're shipping out croissants to a bunch of different shops. And I have numerous other family members who all own donut shops from anywhere from all the way to San Clemente, to Irvine, to San Jose, to Modesto, and a lot of places, really, where it's crazy that I'm related to all of them.
Uncle Ted's impact is just massive. Imagine if instead of going into a donut shop that he had gone to a bowling alley or something.
Right. I think that Uncle Ted was smart. You know, he could see that, number one, donut shops are very profitable. So even if, you know, we have a poor family coming in, if their labor force is their own family, so the labor cost is very low and the gross is very high, he could actually see that this is an opportunity for Cambodian Americans to make it, but also for him to gather a profit as well. So his impact, you know, is very widespread.
Let's talk about your story now. After college, once you decided that being a reporter, being a journalist was not the path that you wanted to take and you were coming home, what were you coming home to? What was DK's Donut Shop like when you came back?
DK's Donut Shop, when I came back in 2012, was very, very simple. You know, it was like any other local donut shop you see. There were the traditional donuts with glazed and sprinkled, jelly filled, twists, bars, old fashions, buttermilks, French crullers. I mean, that was it. And then in terms of fancy donuts, the craziest things were the apple fritter and the, you know, cinnamon roll that we had. The cost was also very low back then. You know, there was nothing really custom or crazy about this shop.
Was it a good business?
It was a great business. I think that DK's Donuts and Bakery in Santa Monica, my parents had built it up for 20 years and they had actually made it into just like a very local spot. Like if you worked in the area, lived in the area, you knew about DK's. And that means all the local mechanics and the car dealerships, two different hospitals, because we're open 24 hours. This was, you know, a staple. And all the neighboring residents who could taste a really good donut already knew about DK's. So I have some regulars who have known me since I was, you know, even in my mom's womb. And they tell me, oh my gosh, you're so big now. You know, I'm 30 years old now, but, you know, they still think I'm 12. And it was very simple. You know, we would have some mornings where we would be busy, but it was not the volume as it is now.
So what was the opportunity that you saw? How did you take your creativity and start implementing changes?
Well, the opportunity that I saw was, okay, I've worked for other people at this point. And I think at that point, I knew that I wanted to be my own boss. I wanted to set my own rules. I was, you know, tired of having things be approved by people. I just wanted to, you know, launch my creativity and trust and know that it was going to be profitable. So what I ended up doing first was I started getting us on social media, primarily Instagram and Facebook and Twitter. And I started to build a community of donut lovers online.
How do you do that?
How did I do that? You know, I just created the account. The account says zero followers. And slowly just started to create content that was relevant. So whether that be pictures of donuts, pictures of people eating donuts, pictures of events that we were going to, pictures of meetings that we've been to, pictures of offices that we've been to. Social media is a great tool for people who don't have a lot of money to start off with in a marketing budget. I could say that to this day, we have never been allotted in DK's Donuts to have a marketing budget. And to really create that donut community, it just took a lot of personal engagement. You know, I have people who have been following us since the very first day. And now we have over 85,000 followers who love everything that we post. And it's incredible. But, you know, it did take some time to get me there.
If you're starting with social media, because you can do that with no budget, even though you're starting with zero followers, but you're doing that consistently, you're building an audience. Does that build into other media like news stories and a movie?
Yeah, absolutely. I think that because we're living in an age where everything's pretty much becoming digital. So now, you know, the old school, you know, word of mouth is the best form of advertising. Well, now you can pretty much be that word of mouth for thousands of people in your circle. And that circle can tell thousands of people in their circle. And thus something becomes viral. The reach that I can reach a customer, not only now in Santa Monica, I can reach a customer all the way in Germany. I can reach somebody in Japan. And I have done so, actually. They've actually come and reached out to us to cover our shop on their segments in their home countries. And it's just, you know, the internet, I think for small businesses and, you know, corporations as well, like the internet has opened up so much opportunity for everyone to get to know the brand, to get to know the products and to have the opportunity to, you know, get one of their products delivered to them or to come visit the shop.
I love that you talk about building community. This is such a powerful tool. Did you start with the social media before introducing changes to the product?
I think both were around the same time because at the shop, as I was saying before, you know, we just had traditional items and a few breakfast items. But I really started to put myself in the shoes of my potential audience. And I thought, why don't we start doing this? So the first thing that I introduced was the ube donut. Ube is a purple yam. It's slightly sweeter than its cousin, taro, which is a little bit nuttier, but both are kind of purple potatoes. But purple, the ube one, is more of, in the Filipino culture. And that inspiration actually came from when I was younger and I had a Filipino best friend and I had some ube desserts at her house. And I thought, oh my God, what is this? It's so good. So my whole goal of that was, let's introduce ube to the whole world and create the world's first ube donut. And also it had B vitamins and antioxidants. It wasn't that sweet. And it was just kind of something very contrastingly different than, most of the other donuts out there, and that you also wouldn't feel so guilty eating a donut. but that was kind of the first thing I worked on as well. Also looking at the aesthetics of everything. Ube is also, this bright purple donut. So it looks very different in comparison to other donuts. And then I introduced the half croissant, half donut. We call it the O-Nut. At the time we had a particular person in New York have a similar product.
Ooh, the controversy.
Yeah, there was a huge controversy over that. And I think that, when I had first introduced the product, this local paper picked it up and we ended up getting picked up on nationwide news sources from USA Today to Thrillist, to more news stations as well. But there became more buzz around the controversy of, the word C-R-O-N-U-T, this half croissant, half donut, that my mom and I and my brother had actually figured out our own recipe and started production in our own location in Santa Monica. So there was also controversy around that.
Tell us how that went. What was that sort of testing period like? How did you come up with your recipe?
My mom is an amazing cook, no matter if she is in the kitchen cooking Asian food or in the shop making donuts. And so when I introduced this concept to her, I said, "Hey, mom, I think we should start making this new thing called a, we called it at that time the double decker O-Nut and the D-K-R-O-N-U-T. And I said, it's a half croissant, half donut. Why don't we put, Nutella and strawberry in it? We can do a cinnamon one, like a churro. We can do a glazed one." And she obviously, like a lot of things when I tell her, she looks at me like I'm crazy. And so we were trying to experiment a few times. Finally, we came up with something delicious and then we put it on our shelves. And for the first 2 weeks, nobody really knew what it was. But people were down to try it. And I think that kind of spread the local word of mouth. And then for me, using my social media channels, I went ahead and started blasting that we have this special item here in Santa Monica, which at that point, nobody in LA was making them. We were the first ones. I remember showing up at 4 a.m. and the phone was ringing nonstop. And they were like, "Hey, do you have this croissant donut?" And I said, "Yeah, we do." And then they're like, "I want a dozen." And I'm like, "Okay." So I write down their order. They're going to come in, an hour or so. And the phone just goes nonstop. And I could tell that our production was not going to keep up with, the actual production of the donuts. We couldn't make them fast enough. The whole wall was covered with orders. And, we had to call for backup. My mom and I were in there working 20-hour days, just ensuring that all the orders were fulfilled. And it became this crazy, crazy thing. And this was one of like the most pinnacle things that we invented at DK's.
Could you meet the demand out of your one shop?
So we ended up being able to meet the demand. We had to bring in more people to work. And honestly, my mom and I put in a lot of work at the shop, just making sure that we could step in and make them as fast enough. But yes, I would say that we ended up getting it under control.
So Mayly, you did something. The phone was ringing off the hook. People must have been coming in droves. There must have been lines that were not there previously to this small local donut shop. What was your family's reaction?
My family's reaction, when I even started putting us on social media, they were like, what are you doing? Why do you keep taking pictures of things? Like, you know, they were unsure of what I was doing already to kind of start off. And I told them, just trust me, you know, I got this. So when the Corona thing started happening, I mean, it was a little bit of like astonishment, but also just like, oh my God, how did you do this? And I think that from that point on, any kind of thing that I did introduce, there was definitely more trust and more of like, okay, like I'm going to help push this along versus let's not do it. And so that's actually demonstrated in my next creations, which is the half waffle, half donut hybrid. We call it the Wow Nut. It's been featured on the Food Network twice, and essentially it's a half waffle, half donut batter, deep fried, and then garnished like a donut. And then you can even add ice cream or fresh fruit. And that was the one after the O-Nut. And when I introduced that, people already knew that it was going to be good. My parents also were helping to push through, making sure that that was going through as well. So I think that anything that I introduced after that became a hit.
Coming up, Mayly inspires other donut shops to change. How she's surviving during COVID-19 while supporting frontline healthcare workers, and a Buddhist temple on the other side of the world. All that and more right after this short break. The show notes for this episode can be found at inspiredmoney.fm/151. If you're listening in your car or wherever you are, check the show notes if you want to learn more about Mayly, DK's donuts, and all other things mentioned in this episode. It's time for the Runnymede Money Tip of the Week. How are you doing during this time of coronavirus? It's pretty tough out there, with daily cases still increasing globally. It's easy to feel powerless right now, but there are ways to help and give back. Even if you're quarantined at home, there are ways to get involved and help others. Research shows that volunteering makes you happier and healthier. This is more important than ever if you're confined at home. Let's take a look at how we can help and give back right now. Number one, start with your community. Reach out to people you know. Check in with neighbors, friends, coworkers, and relatives, especially those in the vulnerable demographic due to age or other condition. Pick up the phone and ask if they need help picking up groceries. Whether they accept your offer or not, it can be a tremendous boost just to have a chat. Two, make a donation. Hospitals, national and local charities that provide housing, financial assistance, or food could use your help. There are also GoFundMe campaigns, so you might check that website out. As mentioned in a previous episode, just ordering takeout from your favorite local restaurant is a big help. Three, you can donate without spending money. With unemployment claims high, food banks are really busy. Support your local food pantry by donating non-perishables like canned foods or pasta. And while many of us take our internet for granted, since many schools and libraries are closed right now, there are people who do not have internet access. There are organizations calling for donations of old devices, like laptop computers and tablets. If you have an old device, consider donating it to somebody in need. This is a challenging time, but it's also a time to be grateful for what we have. Please stay safe and healthy. That's the Runnymede Money Tip of the Week. Inspired Money is brought to you by Runnymede Capital Management. We help you to plan, invest, and worry less. Today's Inspired Moneymaker of the Week, Mike C-Rock Sirocco, sent me a message on LinkedIn. He said, loving this podcast. The last one you did on $9 million real estate portfolio with Lior Rozanski was full of value. Learned a lot. Thank you so much, Mike C-Rock. Want to be the next Inspired Moneymaker of the Week? Take a screenshot of this episode right now and let's do this. What is something that you did recently that was something that scared you? Something that took you out of your comfort zone? I'd love to hear about it. Share it on social media, tag me. I'm inspiredmoney.fm on Instagram or runnymedecap on Twitter. That's RUNNYMEDECAP, short for Runnymede Capital. Use the hashtag inspiredmoney. And as always, you can email me at inspiredmoney.fm/Andy. I'd love to give you a shout out here on the podcast. Share a little motivation for all of us by sharing something that scared you. I look forward to hearing from you. You're listening to Inspired Money. I'm Andy Wong. Do you feel any pressure that a new product idea has to live up to the original croissant donut combination?
I don't think that anything that will be anything in the future will be as crazy as that time of the croissant donut hybrid. I think that there was a lot of hype that was built around it already. So seeing it as kind of like a supply and demand thing, there were not many people making it. So, you know, the demand was very high, but the supply was very low. So, you know, for something so simple as a pastry, people couldn't wait to get their hands on it. So in the future for other products, I think it really depends. It depends on if other people are doing something similar and if it's available, that would probably take it off and, like, you know, make it go off the markets again, like I did with the O-Nut.
You've got the O-Nut, the Wow-Nut. What else do you have up your sleeve?
So we started making these custom alphabet letters, but shaped in donuts. So essentially people could spell messages like happy birthday, I love you, I miss you, I'm sorry, will you go to prom with me, you know, happy 1 year. And these are decorated each individually in their own topping and flavor, which the customer can choose. So whether that be fruity pebbles to rainbow sprinkles, to green frosting, to blue sprinkles, to drizzles, Ferrero Rocher, s'mores, caramel Snickers, bacon bits, you name it. You know, we wanted, for me, this was really for my guests to get creative with their own celebrations and their own experiences. At this point, I started to see that I love to curate these donut experiences. And I love the elements of surprise and showing up and having this be something super delightful. Little did I know that this whole alphabet custom donut situation would actually also appeal to my larger office clients, you know, all the big groups of people who are celebrating birthdays too, but almost as client gifting. So this became a very special addition to, you know, our bottom line, and that to this day, people have been ordering tons of it. After that, I've created the Texas size donut, which is essentially a large donut that's available in 5 different sizes. That's again, you know, donuts are something to be shared. I mean, how many times have you eaten a donut out of a box and you've cut it in half and shared it with somebody? So why not do a larger one for a different occasion? Again, it can be any color you want. It can be orange, it can be pink, it can be all the colors of the rainbow. But again, something to enjoy, like a special treat with somebody for a special occasion or just because that person loves donuts. And then we have the donut bouquet, which is I launched actually as a separate brand called Donut Princess LA, obviously after myself. But it's a little bit different. It's a little bit on the higher end of things. So it's a large pink matte box sealed with a satin ribbon with a display of 6 amazing, beautiful, different types of donuts in a little burlap sack, which becomes, you know, the bouquet with a handwritten note and a special donut princess pin. And so my goal here, again, it's client gifting. It's making somebody feel special, but this is now appealing to the men who never get flowers and instead would love to have donuts where they could actually eat the donuts. And so this was my last kind of large donut experience that I curated that people can order from the store. Besides that, we also have mini donuts where, in, you know, say you don't want to eat that many donuts, we have mini donuts as well. And we also do giant donut walls. So giant donut walls became a big thing. We started making them for weddings, graduations, bar mitzvahs, and birthdays, where it's a huge, large donut wall. It has little pegs where the donuts are hanging on top of it. So it doubles as a donut photo shoot background as well. So this kind of all ties into, you know, the social media aspect. You know, people want to show off what they're eating now. People want to show off their gifts. And here is where I come in and show them all the things they can do with donuts.
It sounds like you have completely transformed the business in about 8 years. You're kind of creating a new category of donut shop. Are you seeing changes to the Cambodian donut industry in California?
I have. I would say that because of all the new changes that I have done, now donut shops have the decision. Do I want to keep things the way they are and have less of a headache? Or do I want to expand and start carrying all these other crazy donuts? Oh, by the way, we expanded our donut showcase to over 120, both hybrid donuts, traditional donuts, and specialty donuts. Not only can people find crazy donuts that are special and custom made, but they can also come in 24 hours a day and see some wild donuts that they've never seen before. So I think for the existing, you know, Cambodian donut culture, they have that decision. Are we going to move forward and take it to the next level, or are we going to keep it the same? I think that for a lot of these Cambodian owned donut shops, a lot of their kids didn't want to come back to the business, you know? And at one point I feel that because it's a lot of work. And so a lot of them have actually sold their shops or kept the same, or they have upgraded themselves to do crazier things.
So what's your vision for the future? Do you want to expand to more units, or do you keep things as they are and just expanding your business lines and products?
I think at this point, we're going to keep the one shop. And I have actually stepped into the role of consulting. So I do consulting for social media and I do consulting for donut shops. So, you know, I've gained all of this experience that I've pretty much figured out on my own. So I could go to any restaurant owner and say, hey, like, I can possibly double your business if you give me a chance to, you know, if you listen to me. And so it's almost like I'm offering my own services to these donut shop owners, to these personal brand people, to these people who want to digitize their businesses and take it to the next level. So my vision is, you know, I want to be there to help people to get to that, and so that they can have a higher quality of living.
I want to talk a little bit about this COVID stay at home, shelter in place environment that we're in now, because it's just impacted everyone, and especially small local businesses. How have you been adapting your business to the current environment?
Well, when COVID-19 happened in March and there was the stay-at-home order where everybody was impacted, and at the point I had even my own ethical questions. Should I be going in and helping out, or am I putting myself and my family in danger? And also, after the announcement, I felt completely helpless. What am I going to do? We had already noticed that with the stay-at-home order, foot traffic had decreased by 30%. We had lost all of our accounts, and we had to figure out something to do to help our business and to keep it afloat so that it could survive through these times. And so immediately, I hit the ground running. I created DK's Donuts into a local grocery store where people could buy ingredients such as flour or water, you know, eggs, butter, vegetables. And this was kind of like, I had the elderly people in mind of the community. Like, what if they didn't want to wait in those long lines at the grocery store, but they needed just a few items at the shop? That's the first thing I did. The second thing I did is I created a virtual store on one of our delivery partners that focused on our savory sandwiches that we have at the shop. In this way, it would help those who are working from home to get something very quick so they could just move on and do their work at home and not worry about it. I started coming up with new concepts to have do-it-yourself donut decorating kits where, you know, you have all these parents now who are dealing with their children and work at the same time, and they need their kids to have something to do. So these little kits could be something that could keep them busy and they can enjoy the treats. But my most important and most fulfilling thing that I created out of COVID-19 is my initiative called Lunchboxes for Love. So my friend Monica and I, we jumped on a call and talked about how helpless we felt. And immediately we got into action and we thought, okay, why don't we do this? Let's collect donations from people and have those donations be the donations to go back into the small business, but also have that be made for so we can make gourmet sandwiches, gourmet donuts, and fresh coffee and deliver them to those that are working on the front lines in hospitals with COVID-19 positive people in them. And so within 2 months, I personally delivered to 40 different hospitals and fed over 2,500 people. We are still in the thick of COVID-19. It's now the second wave, and we are still continuing our mission now. Now, luckily, I have volunteers now who are open to helping me with doing some of the deliveries, but we are still doing 1 to 3 deliveries per week for different hospitals who are in need. And what I had in mind there was these people who are working on the front lines are taking care of our loved ones. You know, it might not be that our loved ones now are COVID-19 positive, but it could be, and they're risking their lives. I mean, I've talked to a few people who I've delivered to, and they're like, I haven't seen my kids in 3 months. I just want to hug them. I just want to kiss them. But because they are on the front lines, you know, they're taking no risks for that. They're already risking their lives, so they don't want to risk their family's lives. The whole point was, let's use our donuts and these gourmet sandwiches as a care package, as a boost of morale, to let them know that the world is thinking about them, and to have them, you know, keep pushing on is the whole thing.
I love it. It shows your empathy, and it's a win-win because you're soliciting donations, but putting it back into the business. You're very hands-on. You are going out to the hospitals to make the deliveries. How has that made you feel?
I think at first, when COVID-19 was, you know, first introduced, I was very scared. And to this day, I'm still so careful. You know, I've got my gloves on, I've got my mask on, I'm careful of what I touch. I'm, you know, delivering with so much extra precautions, and, you know, telling the nurses and doctors, hey, meet me outside at this area over here. And at first I was very scary because I literally felt like I was risking my life and risking the life, you know, of my mom and the people that I live with. But then as I started to go on and I started to think like, wow, like I'm making such a big impact and I can see it literally in front of my eyes, I'm going to keep doing this. And it makes me feel really good. And I, you know, hearing the stories of the people who are actually working at these hospitals has definitely kept me, you know, going on and moving forward. It's even had me reach out to different other groups of people that are impacted, for example, the veterans. So I, you know, for the month of May, our focus of deliveries were for the veteran communities that have been hit by COVID, such as the VA hospital, Fisher House, and Salvation Army, which we've donated to as well. Ultimately, even though it scares me, I have accepted myself as someone who is like an essential worker. I'm willing to go and risk it, but safely, and provide this because I think that the impact I put, that their happiness is a bigger impact than me being scared and hanging out at home.
Well, thank you for helping your community. It is very, very powerful. These initiatives, these ways of adapting your business in these challenging times, is it enough to sustain your business going forward?
I think that, you know, it's hard to say because it's not a stable thing. Before COVID hit, we had all these corporate accounts. So we had, you know, weekly, daily deliveries to different cafes, different churches, different hospitals. I mean, we had these accounts and this was constant. So, but on the other hand, collecting donations, that is not so much very stable. So I don't think that it is going to be enough, but it does help. it also kind of just brings the awareness to the brand, and it lets the people who are supporting us know what we're up to, that we're not just, you know, sitting around and hoping that it's going to get better. Like, we want to contribute as much as we can. I'm a big fan of like paying it forward and really not expecting anything back. And I really think that the more I pay it forward and bring this good to the world selflessly, I mean, it'll eventually come back. I don't know what form it will be, but it's something that I'm not expecting, but I just feel really good doing it.
Did you decide early on that you were going to be the face of DK's Donuts?
No, I didn't. And for the longest time, I hid behind donuts to really become the face of the company. I started to realize that a lot of the customers who would come in, it wasn't really just about the donut anymore. It was the hospitality and the experiences that I would create for people when they came in. And at that point, when I realized my power and I realized that people would recognize me, obviously, and associated with donuts, but now associated with kindness and bravery and entrepreneurship, I think that people have really accepted me as that whole being the face of the company. And I think that I now see it for myself. I never thought that I could be the whole subject of it. But I think that if people have been following me from way in the beginning, they definitely know it's me behind the social media. It's me in front of the photos. It's me representing the donut fanatics of my community. And, you know, honestly, I just want to make everybody proud and happy.
So that part was a little bit scary, but something that you do suggest to other business owners, not to be afraid of being part of their company story on social media.
Yeah, I would say step into the light. You know, people nowadays, like a general audience, people are interested in like how it began. They're interested in the story aspect. They're almost even interested in like the behind the scenes. What is it really like? What's the genuine rawness of the whole story of the place? And I think that the more that, you know, these brands can develop their stories and, you know, create that branding around it, the more depth it is that it's more than just a donut, you know? And now that, you know, when the film comes out, when people take a bite of that donut, they're gonna know that there's so much history behind that one donut, rather than it just be a product versus, you know, a whole story and a whole brand.
It is a very rich history and a fascinating one. I know that you and your mom took a trip back to Cambodia, and I think that it speaks again to you and your family's desire to be giving back.
My mom had told me that she was, you know, in the middle of almost completing a project and that she needed help with it. And so I had to make a decision, and it was almost a no-brainer. I helped my mom finish the temple that she started in Cambodia, and we eventually ended up completing it last year. It was a large Buddhist temple in Cambodia, and the whole point was it's a way to give back and to promote community from the communities that my mom essentially was a part of when she was young before the war. And it has always been her dream to complete this temple. We got the honor to meet the prime minister, and we had over 800 monks, 500 nuns, and 300 members of the community come out. We were doing donations, blessings. And on top of that, this is something that we're going to leave here on this earth. When we're all gone, we're going to leave this temple here, and it will live on for centuries and centuries after, both being a place for education, for being a place for community, and just a place of belonging. It's somewhere where they can go to if there's something that's wrong or if they want to just show respect. I'm really, really proud of my mom and I for completing the project. And, you know, I know that this is something that my mom will take with her forever, that she and I completed this together and that I had helped her through it. But, you know, what my visions of that, of having something over there is, wow, like this is going to be something that when I die, it'll still be there and that people will still be able to benefit from it for years to come.
Yeah. Powerful legacy.
Yes.
Mayly, I like to ask all the Inspired Money guests, how do you define success?
I think success is a word that you can put your own meaning to. A lot of people define success with money and being a millionaire. A lot of people define success with things, having a lot of things. But for me, like my version of success, success is figuring out what's important to you and working to achieve that. I think that success, it really resonates with your own values. And for me, that's leaving legacy, it's family, it's community, it's doing good in the world. And for as long as I can have my own passions in hospitality, in service to others, you know, success for me is something that I celebrate on the daily. There are a million things that are thrown at me, including, you know, this morning, especially, you know, like it's just, it's the price that you pay for being the best version of yourself. And it becomes your success as you define it, because it's different for everyone.
What happened this morning?
Oh, it's we had a very large delivery of different orders, and you know, some of the deliveries didn't have unit numbers. Some of the drivers had to double back. Communication problems with like different tablets, you know, just people reaching out and having questions. So it's just a really busy morning any other day, but you know, I have my best friend who he constantly reminds me, he's like, well, this is the life that we get. You know, this is the small price that we pay for having all these responsibilities, but also being able to know how to respond and resolve those issues almost naturally.
Well, thank you. Thank you, Mayly, for joining us and sharing your amazing entrepreneurial story, your family's story, and sharing all the good that you guys are doing in the community in California, but also in Cambodia on the other side of the world. Can you tell the Inspired Money listener where they can follow you and learn more about donuts? Particularly, I want to find out about the ube donut. You couldn't see me earlier, but my mouth was watering.
That often happens anytime I come around anybody, their mouths start watering because I have some kind of donut spidey sense. But people can definitely find me online. So I have my own podcast. It's called Short and Sweet, a Donut Princess podcast that can be found on Apple and Spotify and Stitcher. People can follow DK's Donuts. That's at DKS Donuts, at Donut Princess LA, at Mayly Tao, at Food for the Clout. That's my food Instagram. People can find us on TikTok at I Love DK's Donuts. People can find us on Twitter, on Facebook, again, DK's Donuts and Bakery. You know, if you need to reach me, my email is hello@donutprincessla.com. If they are seeking my services, they need my help, or they just want to chat, you know, I am open to getting to know people and to meeting people and expanding what good I can create in this world.
All the places, I will put them in the show notes. Thank you so much, Mayly.
Thank you as well.
So what was your favorite Inspired Money moment? Mayly is a force. I appreciate her creativity, hard work, and how she's adapting her business during challenging times. Everything from the O-Nut to the Wow-Nut to going out helping frontline healthcare workers and veterans. It's all about making her parents proud, growing the business, and giving back. And perhaps the biggest takeaway of all, building a Buddhist temple that will still be here hundreds of years from now. The idea of legacy is very cool, especially when Mayly can appreciate that at age 30. Would you like an Inspired Money sticker or button? Maybe both? Take a screenshot of this episode and then take that image and share something that you did recently that scared you. Something that you're grateful that you did because it took you out of your comfort zone. I'd love to hear about it. Share it on social media, tag me, I'm inspiredmoney.fm on Instagram, or runnymedecap on Twitter. That's RUNNYMEDECAP. Use the hashtag inspiredmoney. I'd love to give you a shout out here on the podcast, and I'll mail you a sticker, button, or one of each. Inspired Money is edited by Christopher Wright of Wright Media. Thank you so much for joining me. If you're not yet subscribed, please do it now so that you won't miss next week's episode. I look forward to seeing you then. The music you're listening to right now and all other music on today's show is by the amazing Jim Kimo West. Have an inspired week and do something that scares you, because that's where the magic happens.